because it is related to the Catholic Church, where also the number three plays a big role. Dreieinigkeit, as it's called in German. What I told him, that I don't think that he is right. So, based on the standard model, we have now the problem to understand these fundamental constants. How many constants we really have? Well, a very large number. Here is now a list. I started with Newton's constant G. Then the next one is the fine structure constant. Then we have the lambda C for the QCD. There is a coupling constant for the weak interaction. There is also the, these are all the coupling constants, three, because there are three gauge groups. It's the three of color times SU2 times U1. But then there's the mass of the weak boson, the mass of the Higgs boson. There are six quarks and six electrons, each of them have a mass, so 12 masses. There is a phenomenon for the quarks, which is called flavor mixing. It has to do with the fact that in a weak interaction, if you look at beta decay, then there are transitions between the quarks, but these transitions involve mixtures of mass eigenstates. That's called flavor mixing. And described by three mixing angles and one phase parameter, so four parameters. And there's also flavor mixing of the leptons, which is, for example, known or observed in terms of neutrino oscillations. These are also described by three mixing angles and one phase parameter. But it could well be that for leptons we have two more phase parameters, so altogether six. So if you add all this, you come to 28. So it's a very large number of free parameters. I like to describe this fundamental constant in terms of a big circle. Outside you have the various fermion masses, the up charm and top quark mass, the three neutrino masses, the masses of the down quarks, the masses of the three charged leptons here. Here you have the flavor mixing parameters for leptons and for quarks here. In the middle, you have the three coupling constants, the fine structure constant, alpha strong, for the strong interaction, or lambda sub c, alpha for the weak interaction, and in the middle, of course, Newton's constant. Again, if you count this, it is 28. Now, 22 out of these 28, all the things which are underlined here, are multiplied with the fermion masses. In other words, if the masses for leptons and quarks are set to zero, is a certain first approximation, then all these underlying parameters would disappear. And in this case, we would only have six parameters, namely Newton's constant, the three coupling constant here, the mass of the weak boson, and the mass of the Higgs boson. Also here I have a little table for the various masses. The first generation, the first family of leptons and quarks is given here. That's the electron mass, neutrino mass is zero. And then there are the two quark masses. Here you have the second family, and here's the third family. You see the three families are a bit separated nicely. The top quark is very heavy, and the weak boson masses are given here. This is the Z boson, that's the charged weak boson. And here I put in the Higgs boson, which I use as the mass of 126 GeV as observed at CERN. Whether this is a Higgs boson, we still don't know. But that's a possibility. Now in the standard model, these fundamental constants are just really fundamental numbers. And people think they are completely universal. Everywhere in the world they are the same, and they are, you cannot change them. We still don't understand where they come from, but they are fixed. But the question nevertheless comes, are the fundamental constants functions of space and time? Could it be that in a different galaxy, the fine structure constant has a different value as in our galaxy, for example? Well, the first information on this comes from the so-called Oklo reactor. This is a reactor discovered in Gabon in Africa. And it was a natural reactor which existed about 2 billion years ago. And the so-called natural reactor, because 2 billion years ago there was nobody who could build a reactor except nature itself. And now at that time it was easy to build a natural reactor, or relatively easy, because the uranium-235, which you need for a reactor, was around for 3.7% of all the uranium. Now today it has gone down to 0.72% because of beta decay. And accidentally in the Oklo region in Africa, there was also a river called the Oklo River, and the water from the river Oklo acted as a moderator for this reactor. This reactor was discovered in 1972 by French nuclear physicists. It was a very small reactor. Its energy output was only 100 kilowatts, so very, very little. But this output came in for about 100 million years. So it was this reactor existed for a very long time. Here you see the Africa, and here's the state of Gabon with Oklo. Here a bigger picture where you see the river Oklo here. Again, this is Africa. Here it's also a bad picture which I took from the internet from the river Oklo. And what was interesting in this reactor, which was excavated by the French and studied in detail, is a reaction involving the element samarium. Samarium is a rare earth element, as a sort of a metal. And if you bombard samarium with neutrons, you produce samarium 150 under photon. And the cross section for this reaction had been studied by reactors, and it's huge, about 80 kilopascals, a very, very large cross section. And now it is understood why this large cross section is there, why it is so large. There is a nuclear resonance just above the threshold, about 0.1 electron volt above threshold. And it was figured out by physicists, and most precisely actually by Freeman Dyson and his French collaborator Damour, already in 1996, that because the cross section for the samarium reaction had been measured at Oklo, even today, and it was known that the resonance position could not have been changed very much during the last 2 billion years. Now we observe that large cross section, and at that time it must also be very large. And that is what was derived by Dyson and Damour. Because the position of that resonance depends on the fine structure constant. Of course, the samarium nucleus is a nucleus, but if you change the fine structure constant, you change the mass of the nucleus. So one was able to conclude that the alpha value, the fine structure constant of 2 billion years ago, compared with the fine structure now, divided by alpha, this difference must be less than 10 to the minus 7. And if you make a linear approximation, you come to the conclusion that the yearly change of the fine structure constant could not be very large. It's less than 10 to the minus 16 very rare. But this is only true if no other parameters, which also might influence the resonance, the position of the resonance, There's no other bar will change. But there's another information coming from astrophysics. People have looked at the fine structure of atomic levels very close to distant quasars. The quasars are way back, several billion years back in time. And this has been done, in particular, with a lot of quasars. And what you do is you look at the quasar light going through a gas cloud close to the quasar, making atomic transitions in here. And then the light reaches the Earth, and here you investigate these atomic transitions. And this has been done in particular with the Keck telescope in Hawaii. It's a picture of the Keck telescope. And the experiment was done by an Australian experimentalist, George Webb, together with Art Wolf, a professor in San Diego, in California. Also together with Flambaum, a Russian theoretician working in Sydney, and a fairly large group. And since they started about 20 years ago, and they looked at the fine structure of metals like iron, nickel, magnesium, and so on, and studying quasars up to 11 billion years back in time. And they found that a slight change of the fine structure constant of the order of 10 to minus 5 compared to the fine structure constant at the quasar minus fine structure constant now. So you see the error is relatively small, seems to be a positive effect. And if you make a linear approximation, you conclude that there is a yearly change of the fine structure constant of the order of close to 10 to minus 15 per year. These are the experimental data. When I make a linear approximation, it means you put a straight line through, since it may not be a great approximation. Here is the Big Bang. Here is the present time. It's called the fractional look-back time. And you see the effect here. Now, if you take this value as measured, and makes this linear approximation, there is a conflict with what you conclude from the Oklo reactor. Because in Oklo, I said that this change must be less than 10 to minus 16, which disagrees with this value. But I also said that no other parameters are supposed to change, otherwise the Oklo constraint is not valid. And that's precisely what's happening. And I'll come back later to this. Well, when I heard about this, I started to look at details. And you know, a long time ago, I proposed with Peter Minkowski, a professor in Bern, and also Howard Georgi at Harvard, that there may be a grand unified theory based on the group SO10. And that group embeds the standard model gauge group, SO3 times SO2 times SO1 for the standard model, which would be a subgroup of SO10. The SO10, if SO10 breaks down, it breaks down into two simple groups, SO6 times SO4. And some of you might know from mathematics, SO6 is isomorphic to SU4. And SO4 is isomorphic to SU2 times SU2. That's for left and right-handed fermions. And that was your news. SU4 was considered to be the group including the color group SU3. And SU2 times SU2 was supposed to embed finally the standard electro weak gauge group SU2 times U1. And so it looks like this. If you have such a grand unification, you have at low energies the three coupling constants, the fine structure constant, the weak coupling constant and the strong interaction coupling constant. But then they are reduced to two parameters, namely the unified coupling constant and the scale where the unification takes place. There are two parameters. So there is a non-trivial constraint. You can look at this way, and it's a rather bad picture. here you write down the electromagnetic fine structure constant, actually the inverse. Here's the same for the weak interaction and for the strong interaction. And if there is a grand unification, these three coupling constants, if they evolve at the end as a function of the energy, you can calculate from quantum theory the change of these parameters. They should converge to a single number up here. That would be called grand unification. This happens at extremely high energies. You see here the energy scale, slightly above 10 to the 15 GeV, a very, very big energy. Now suppose there is a time change of the fine structure constant. Well, if the fine structure constant changes and you have grand unification, also the other coupling constant should change. And in particular, the strong interaction coupling would change. If this goes down, this would go down, and this would also go down. The weak interaction would also go down, but it is very little is known about the weak interactions. You could also make another change. You could change not the coupling constant, but change the scale of unification. In other words, put this here to the left. In this case, this would go up, but the strong coupling constant would go down, or the other way around. So there's a difference now. So these two things could be there. And this had been calculated together. I did the calculation together with a graduate student. It was also done by Langacker and Gray in the United States in 2002. And that's the equation which we got. That's for alpha, this is alpha strong. And this is the grand unification mass scale, where the grand unification takes place. This constant can also be calculated, but it's a very complicated constant which I didn't put in here in detail. Now if this the grand unification scale doesn't change, you can cross out this term, and then you have a very simple relationship between alpha and alpha strong. Now, so if you take now here the change of alpha as observed by Mr. Webb with the quasars, you can calculate the effect for alpha strong, and in turn you can calculate the change for the change of the lambda c. And this is what you expect. It's about 40 times the change of alpha. And this is a rather large effect, and it would imply that the mass for the proton or the mass of any atomic nucleus would change in time. But you also would get a change of time of the magnetic moments of the atomic nuclei. And when I take this astrophysics value as a basis, I conclude that the change of the magnetic moment should be about 4 times 10 to minus 14 per year. That could be measured in quantum optics. If on the other hand the unification scale is changing, you can again calculate the change for lambda c, but then it's the opposite. It's now a negative sign, but again a large number. Before it was 40 here, now it's minus 31. So very roughly speaking, it's about 2 orders of magnitude. So the change of alpha is observed by the Mr. Webb and his group is 10 to minus 15 per year, then I would expect a change of lambda c of the order of 10 to minus 14 per year. And that, when I realized this in 2003, I went to my friend Theodor Hensch in Munich and asked him whether he could do an experiment. And it started a big group of experiments, both at the Max Planck Institute for Quantum Optics in Munich and also at the American Laser Institute in Boulder, Colorado. We measure time now in physics by using cesium clocks. And with a cesium clock, you take you consider a hyperfine transition, which of course depends on the magnetic moment of the cesium nucleus. And based on the cesium clock, we define time in this way. that the agrafine transition in cesium has this frequency in terms of hertz. Hertz is inverse of a second. So this defines now a second. So this is now an integer number. There's not a comma here and another number coming on. It's just fixed to here. That defines now in quantum optics what a second is. What I realized, if you do not consider a cesium clock, but consider instead a hydrogen clock, then there should be a disagreement between the two. Because in the cesium clock, you depend on the magnetic moment of the cesium nucleus. In a hydrogen clock, you just depend on the fine structure constant. And I calculated there should be a difference of 3 cesium oscillations per day, every day, if you compare a hydrogen clock with a cesium clock. And I called up Theodor Hedge and told him this story, this 3 cesium oscillation. And he said immediately that he could measure it. That's a picture of Theodor Hedge. And the experiments he did now subsequently with his hydrogen clock gave him the Nobel Prize in 3 years later, in 2006. In his experiment, he had his hydrogen clock, he calls it a hydrogen spectrometer, is based on a laser. And he compared this with a cesium clock, the best cesium clock which is known right now, which has a name Pharao, and it's usually in Paris. And this cesium clock was brought to Munich several times and come now compared. Hedge is able to measure in his hydrogen clock the 1s, 2s transition of hydrogen with incredible accuracy of the order of 10 to minus 15. You see here, the uncertainty is only 18 hertz. And he thinks he could improve this by another 3 orders of magnitude in the next 3 or 4 years. And this is the experiment of Theodor Hedge. I don't understand too much of it, except I know hydrogen is in here. But otherwise, it's a big clock here. And when I call the magnetic moment of the cesium clock mu, and this is now the time change, that was what Hedge obtained in his first experiments. You see the error is large, 0 is not excluded, but the uncertainty is very precise, 10 to minus 15 per year. And I had expected it should be 2 times 10 to minus 14 per year. And you see, if you compare this is excluded. So I thought for a while that this is now useless. It seems that nature doesn't follow the grand unified picture, or something is wrong with the Webb experiment. But then I got some other input from Ed Witten. He came to Munich for a few months, and he was interested in my calculation. And Witten argued there could be at the same time a change of the unified coupling constant and of the unification scale. And then on the right-hand side of my equation, you could have a partial calculation. And Witten calculated that this calculation happens precisely in superstring theories. When I realized this, the argument of Witten, he calculated this in superstring theories and concluded that this is negative here, this constant is negative, and in such a way that there could be a partial cancellation. So in other words, you could have both this kind of change of the unification scale and the change of the coupling constant. Then, of course, what happens at low energies depends on details. And the effect could be at least an order of magnitude less than I was calculating before. So when I realized this, I went again to Hedge and asked him to do another experiment, which he is still doing now. And recently he came up with a new number, and he concludes that the change of the QCD scale is of the order of 3 × 10⁻⁵ per year. The error is still quite large, so he didn't publish it so far. He just speaks about it at conferences. But in the meantime, something else happened. Namely, a professor from Amsterdam in the Netherlands did experiments with a very large telescope in Chile. Ordered in 2006. And Reinhold found this now. He studied two quasars, both of them extremely far away, almost at the Big Bang, 12 billion years. And he looked at hydrogen transitions. And he concluded that the mass, introduced this parameter rho, which is the mass for the proton divided by the mass of the electron, he finds a non-trivial change of this rho. Now, if you say, well, the QCD lambda is changing, the mass of the electron stays constant, you get an information about lambda, that's what you get. It would be of the order of 3 × 10⁻⁵ per year. That's precisely what Hensch also has measured. So Hensch did this experiment here in the laboratory, and Reinhold in using distant quasars. And we also checked that there's the same sign, the same order of magnitude, also the same sign as the result seen in Munich. So if this is correct, it would imply that the masses of all atomic nuclei will depend on time, which means, slightly speaking, that the energy is not strictly conserved. So I come now to the conclusions. I discuss these 28 constants of nature we have. Maybe it's just 26. Then 24 of these constants are just mass parameters, like the mass for the electron or lambda sub c. The Grand Unified Theory, the electroweak theory and the QCD theory come together in one theory. And based on this, the time variation of the fine structure constant can be used to say something about the time variation of the QCD scale. And based on this, we now seem to find that the change of QCD scale is of the order of 3 × 10⁻⁵ per year. So the fundamental constants might all not be constant. They might be functions of time, very slow varying in time. And that would be important for cosmology also. You know, in our people now speak, even in cosmology, speak about, not about the universe, but they call it a multiverse. That's the structure of the multiverse, the funny picture. This is our universe here, the various galaxies. But then here's another universe, here's another big universe. Here are very small universes which decay after 1 microsecond already. But anyway, this is now our galaxy. If you look close, you see the city of Taipei, it's right here. Well, you would have to enlarge it to see the city. Anyway, that's now our universe. And here, at the beginning, at the Big Bang, the fundamental constants are created. How they are created in detail, we still don't understand. Now, Miracle Man thinks, because like Pauli, he thought a lot about the fundamental constant, and he considered the fundamental constant to be cosmic accidents. In other words, when you have the Big Bang here, at the beginning, the fundamental constants are not constant at all, they are changing. They are just functioning very quickly changing in time. And only if the universe has a certain critical size of the order of 10 meters or so, macroscopic size, then all of a sudden these constants are nailed down to particular values. But if you would repeat the Big Bang, make it another Big Bang, you would get different fundamental constants. They are just accidentally chosen at the end. And so this is now my last picture. It seems, and now, that the fundamental